Our next strange character in the scriptures is a character, a creature named Leviathan. And he is a very strange character. Now imagine with me that you are in a deep, dark part of the sea, and you have a flashlight on your head, and you're about to get a glimpse of the original sea monster. All the Hollywood creature features, Jaws, all that stuff, that's nothing compared to this. This is a sea creature that no mortal man can hook or draw up with a cord. There's only one man who can do that, and I'm going to show you who later. So Job 41 is where we're at. Job 41:1. It says, "Canst thou draw out Leviathan with an hook, or his tongue with a cord which thou lettest down?" Can you draw out Leviathan with an hook? Well, the way to draw out Leviathan is by using the right bait. And in this case, in the book of Job 41, Job is the bait on the hook. And the Lord put him on the hook. Remember back there in chapter 1 when the Lord asked the devil, "Hast thou considered my servant Job?" He's like, baiting him. What a terror it would be to have your name inserted there as the bait on the hook for Leviathan. At the same time, what an honor to be thought of by the Lord as he thought of Job. But sometimes you are the bait on the hook. Satan is your adversary, Peter says. He says he's a roaring lion. He walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Sometimes you are the bait on the hook. While Behemoth of Job 40 that we talked about was a land animal that pictured the Antichrist and the devil, Leviathan is a sea monster that pictures the devil. You see, God uses things that you can see to picture something you can't see. You know, Romans 1:20, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead." And Job knew of or could have seen himself a sea monster called Leviathan. And God is once again reminding Job that just like he can't take on Behemoth, he can't take on Leviathan. And if he can't take on Behemoth or Leviathan, who is much fierce and worse than a Megalodon or a Jaws or that big crocodile off that movie that people was afraid of, if he can't take on these creatures, then he definitely can't take on God who put Leviathan in the sea, who put Behemoth on the land, and who made the sea and the land that it inhabits. So how do we know for sure who Leviathan is? Well, we got to use scripture with scripture. In Psalm 104:26, it says, "There go the ships, there is that Leviathan, whom thou hast made to play therein." So we know Leviathan is an actual sea creature of some sort, but just as Behemoth, he pictures something far worse. Look at Psalm 74:14. It says, "Thou breakest the heads of Leviathan in pieces, and gavest him to be meat to the people inhabiting the wilderness." So we know Leviathan certainly isn't a crocodile or any sea creature that you know of, because he has more than one head. Who does that remind you of? Well, once again, it reminds us of the devil and the Antichrist. Just like in Revelation 13:1, it says, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads." Seven heads. And the chapter before that, Revelation 12, the devil is a great red dragon with heads, Revelation 12:3. "And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having seven heads." So imagine a dragon in the sea, swimming around like a serpent. It's got more than one head. And now I'm going to show you the only one who can put an end to Leviathan. In Isaiah 27 and verse 1, it says, "In that day the Lord with his sore and great and strong sword shall punish Leviathan, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked serpent. And he shall slay the dragon that is in the sea. The Lord is the original dragon slayer. Any of this dragon slayer stuff that you see is just a copycat. The Lord is the real dragon slayer. It is the Lord himself that is the only one who can slice Leviathan up and make him be food for the people in the wilderness. It is with his sword that he does it. Just like he said when referring to Behemoth in Job 40:19, when he said, he that made him can make his sword approach unto him. He that made him. Who made him? The Lord himself. Only the Lord can make his sword approach unto him. That same sword is the sword you have in your hand. It is your defense against the forces of darkness. Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Also notice it calls Leviathan a serpent in Isaiah 27:1, and it called him a dragon. So who does that remind you of? Just as the devil is a serpent and a dragon. Revelation 20 and verse 2. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. So, Leviathan, no doubt about it, he's a creature. He was some type of sea creature that was around, definitely around during Job's time. Maybe he's still around now somewhere and we just don't know about it. But he's definitely a creature that pictures something far scarier than that, which is the devil himself. The devil will have his end, but right now, you might be a worm on the hook, just as Job called himself. And Job 25:6, how much less man that is a worm, and the son of man, which is a worm. And then in Psalm 22:6, but I am a worm, and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. That is a prophecy of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, who voluntarily became a worm for us. And let the principalities and powers of the spirit world bite and mutilate him. But then when he died, he pulled out that sword and snatched the keys of hell and of death and rose from the dead. And one day he'll have the devil in the grave and the lake of fire, and he won't be able to get out. Isaiah 14:11, talking about the devil. Thy pomp is brought down to the grave, and the noise of thy vials. The worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. So canst thou draw out Leviathan with an hook? Well, the Lord can. Job 41:2, canst thou put an hook into his nose, or bore his jaw through with a thorn? Well, we can't get close to his nose, but the Lord can. He can take the thorns that Satan caused back there in Genesis 3 and bore them through his jaws. Canst thou put a hook into his nose, or bore his jaw through with a thorn? Job 41:3, will he make many supplications unto thee? Will he speak soft words unto thee? Well, he's not going to ask us for anything. In other words, he's not going to beg for mercy from us. But when he stands in front of the Almighty, he will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Romans 14:11, for it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. Philippians 2:10-11, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So he will bow. And he's not going to make supplications to us. But you know, before the devil does anything to anybody, he has to get permission from the Lord himself. He couldn't have got a hold of Job without permission. So he's not going to make supplications to us. But there's somebody he has to talk to, and that's the Lord. In Job 41:4, it says, will he make a covenant with thee? Wilt thou take him for a servant forever? Now, he will make a covenant with you for your soul. Ever heard of people who sold their soul to the devil? I'm sure you've heard it many times. You know, Robert Johnson, Katy Perry, Eminem, Kanye West, Bob Dylan, many others claim to have sold their soul. And maybe they don't sign a piece of paper and shake hands with the devil, but they came to a crossroads in their life where they could have went this way or that way, and they said, I'm going to go this way, and I'm going to reject Jesus Christ and live this life for fame and fortune. And they scoffed at the good and narrow way. In that sense, they did sell their soul. They made a covenant there. Eminem said, I sold my soul to the devil, and I'll never get it back. And the thing is, though, he could get it back if he came to Jesus Christ and put his trust in him to be saved. But you can make a covenant with the devil, but he won't become your servant. You'll be his servant. Job 8:34, Jesus answered them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. Wilt thou make a covenant with him? Will he make a covenant with thee? Wilt thou take him for a servant forever? He can't be your servant, you'll be his. But the devil is God's servant. He can't bite unless God lets him. God uses him as a rod to judge. Just like it talks about the Assyrian, God calls the Assyrian in Isaiah 10:5, O Assyrian, the rod of mine anger, and the staff in their hand is mine indignation. God uses the devil as the rod of his anger. In Job 41:5, it says, Wilt thou play with him as with a bird, or wilt thou bind him for thy maidens? Well, you can't play with him like a bird. But throughout the scriptures, he's compared to one. In Matthew 13:3-4, it says, And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Just like when a preacher preaches and he gets the word in your heart, and then comes something and snatches it right out of your heart. That's why he says in Matthew 13:19, When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. You see, the devil is compared to a bird. Many times devils are compared to birds. Unclean birds picture unclean spirits in the Bible. So wilt thou play with him as with the bird, or wilt thou bind him for thy maidens? Well, you can't bind him. They tried to bind that maniac in the Gospels. Remember, it said over there in the Gospels, he had been often bound with fetters and chains, but they had been broken in pieces and plucked asunder by him. See, you can't bind him, but God has a chain that can bind him. The Lord has a chain for the devil. In Revelation 20:1-2, it says, And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. So the Lord's got a chain that can lock him down. In Job 41:6, shall the companions make a banquet of him? Shall they part him among the merchants? Shall they make a banquet of him? Well, the Lord goes hunting and brings home dinner. And then they will make a banquet of him, literally. Psalm 74:14, Thou breakest the heads of Leviathan in pieces, and gavest him to be the meat, to be meat to the people inhabiting the wilderness. Job 41:7, Canst thou fill his skin with barbed irons, or his head with fish spears? Well, the Lord can. He can get under his skin. He can fill his skin with barbed irons. He can get under his skin, literally. And funny, it mentions his head with fish spears. That's where the devil has been getting it since Genesis 3. He's been getting it in the head. Genesis 3:15. The Lord said to the serpent back there, He said, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. He told him that he was going to bruise his head. So throughout the scriptures, you'll see the picture of the serpent getting his head bruised. From David hitting Goliath in the head with a stone, which the stone pictures Jesus Christ. He's the stone of stumbling, the rock of offense, the stone cut without hands. So from David hitting Goliath in the head with a stone all the way to the Antichrist getting a deadly head wound in Revelation 13, you see a picture. You see pictures of the devil getting a head wound. And even before David hitting Goliath in the head, you're seeing the enemies of God, the devil's men, getting head wounds. So it's nothing for the Lord to fill Leviathan's head with fish spears. In Job 41:8, it says, lay thine hand upon him, remember the battle, do no more. Once you fight Leviathan, you won't want to do it anymore. There is only one man who whoops Leviathan every time. It's the man Christ Jesus, who is also Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, the Almighty. He flooded him back there in Genesis 1-2. He took his legs out from under him in Genesis 3. He overcame him in Matthew 4, even while fasting in a body of flesh. And he will chain him at the second coming and toss him in a lake of fire at the white throne. He whoops him every time, but you can't take him on. In Job 41:9, behold, the hope of him is in vain. Shall not one be cast down even at the sight of him? He has no hope of redemption. The hope of him is in vain. He has no hope when it comes to winning against the Lord. And anyone who trusts in him is hopeless. So when you were a child of the devil, you were having no hope and without God in the world, just like Paul talks about in Ephesians. And if you saw Leviathan, you would be cast down even at the sight of him. Seeing him would freak out the average man so bad he wouldn't be able to stand on his feet. In Job 41:10, it says, none is so fierce that dare stir him up. Who then is able to stand before me? So nobody dares stand before Leviathan, not even a daredevil. Now, that's where that saying comes from. Michael didn't even bring against him a railing accusation in the book of Jude. So the Lord is saying to Job, nobody can stand before Leviathan. Nobody dare do that. So how can you stand before me? None is so fierce that dare stir him up. Who then is able to stand before me, Job? You think you can stand before me? You can't even stand before Leviathan. I made Leviathan. In Job 41:11, who hath prevented me that I should repay him? You know, who's given me something that I should have to give him something? Whatsoever is under the whole heaven is mine. The Almighty could literally look Leviathan in the eyes and say, you are mine. Everything under the whole heaven is his. Man, animal, spirit, whatever it is. Job 41:12, I will not conceal his parts, nor his power, nor his comely proportion. So the Lord isn't going to keep him a secret. He doesn't want you to be ignorant of his devices, 2 Corinthians 2:11. He's not going to conceal his power. So he said, I'm not going to conceal his parts, nor his power, nor his comely proportion. He wants you to know about him. He doesn't want you to be blindsided by him. 2 Corinthians 2:11, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. If he's got a jump on you and you don't know his tactics, he's got a big time advantage on you. So he's not going to conceal his parts. You know, he's told you he's a serpent. He's told you he's a dragon. That tells you enough right there. Look at the things that you can see, and it'll reveal to you the things that you can't see. You see a serpent, automatically, before you even knew about a snake as a kid, and you saw it, you was creeped out by it. God put it in you to know, stay away. I will not conceal his parts, nor his power. What is he called? Ephesians 2:2. He is the prince of the power of the air. Ephesians 2:2, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So his power, he's the prince of the power of the air. What does that remind you of? airwaves. You know, they say we got all these airwaves going through the air. No wonder everybody's so crazy. Luke 10:18, Jesus said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. And so he's connected with electricity. Also take into consideration how when those cherubims move, it's like lightning. Satan is the anointed cherub. He's the prince of the power of the air. The Lord's not going to conceal his parts nor his power. Think about the power of darkness. The devil's got power. There's power in darkness. You see those, think about any concert. You go in, how much power's in there, in the music, in the atmosphere. He's got a lot of power. Nor, I will not conceal his parts, nor his power, nor his comely proportion, his graceful form. You see, he moves around smooth like a serpent. He appears as an angel of light. He doesn't always appear like a roaring lion. He can appear like an angel of light. It says, who can discover the face of his garment? You can't skin him, you see. You're not going to be able to skin him like a crocodile hunter would skin a crocodile. Who can discover the face of his garment? Or who can come to him with his double bridle? You're not going to be able to put a bridle on those jaws. You thought jaws was bad. Try putting a double bridle on the shark jaws. You can't do that, let alone put one on Leviathan. Who can come to him with his double bridle? You can't come to him with the bridle. You couldn't control him. You couldn't ride him. It says in verse 14, who can open the doors of his face? Well, if he was a crocodile, you could. You see, men jump on top of a crocodile, open his mouth, close his mouth, hold his mouth shut. You can't do that with a Leviathan. It says his teeth are terrible round about. And teeth are intimidating looking. That's why you see some of these horrible characters in Scripture show up. It talks about their teeth, like in Revelation 9, those locusts. It said they got hair like as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. What's the devil? A roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. You see, all this is connected here. Daniel 7, verse 7. It says, after this I saw in the night visions, and I beheld a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth, and it devoured and brake in pieces. So iron teeth. So, intimidating thing. But you know what the Lord can do? Psalm 58, verse 6. Break their teeth, O God, in their mouth. All it takes, one hit from the Almighty, and he can break the teeth in Leviathan's mouth and the devil's mouth. Joel 1, 6. In Joel 1, 6, it says, for a nation has come upon my land, strong without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. You see, the enemy, sharp teeth. What's intimidating? You go up to somebody's house, you're knocking on doors, and you see a big dog there, and he starts showing those teeth. That's intimidating. But imagine Leviathan raising up in front of you, and he shows those iron teeth, those teeth like a lion. Imagine iron lion teeth. Just say, break the teeth, O God, in their mouth. The Lord can take him on. We can't take him on. Job can't take him on, but the Lord can take him on. Job 41:15, his scales are his pride, shut up together with a close seal. So here's the problem, his pride. You know, the devil's got a huge pride problem, in case you didn't know it. Psalm 10:4, the wicked through the pride of his countenance will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. What do you think the devil won't seek after God? Why would the devil never have sought after God? Because of his pride. His scales are his pride. Isaiah 14:12-14. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. See the pride? He sinned way before he was in the garden with Adam and Eve. He had a pride problem. His scales are his pride. He was lifted up because of his beauty. Shut up together as with a close seal. Ezekiel 28:17. You know what it says? Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. His scales are his pride. Shut up together as with a close seal, like a shield. One is so near to another that no air can come between them. It's like he's got a shield on his body. They are joined one to another. They stick together that they cannot be sundered. So his body is like a built-in shield, and it can't be sundered. You try to stab him, your sword's just going to break in half. But notice that word, sundered. I think that's significant because there is a weapon that can kill Leviathan. And the Lord has it. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and spirit. Piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. Notice that, dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and as a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So you see, the word of God is a two-edged sword. It's God's sword. It says that, Leviathan cannot be sundered. But what does the word of God do? It divides asunder. So you see, the Lord's weapon can take on Leviathan. Job 41:18, by his kneesings a light doth shine, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. So by his kneesings, that's his sneezing. When he sneezes, fire shoots out. By his kneesings a light doth shine. So he's got light. 2 Corinthians 11:14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. I imagine a big dragon sneezing, out shoots fire. Out of his mouth go burning lamps, and sparks of fire leap out. He's a fire-breathing dragon. Where do you think they came up with that? It's from the devil himself. Out of his nostrils goeth smoke, out as out of a seething pot or cauldron. So, somebody said his kids like peace pipes. You know why? Daniel 8:24-26, the Antichrist comes in peaceably. And out of the devil's nostrils goeth smoke, as out of a smoking pot or cauldron. His breath kindleth coals, and a flame goeth out of his mouth. But you know what? The Lord does the same thing. The devil's the greatest imitator of the Lord. 2 Samuel 22:9, talking about the Lord. Look what it says. There went up a smoke out of his nostrils, and fire out of his mouth devoured. Coals were kindled by it. That's just like what the devil's trying to intimidate. He breatheth, his breath kindleth coals, and a flame goeth out of his mouth. The devil is the biggest imitator of the Lord. The devil wants to be just like him. God has a bride, the devil has a bride. God quotes the word, the devil quotes the word. God is referred to as a lion. Jesus Christ is the lion of the tribe of Judah. The devil is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. God is light. The devil appears as an angel of light. God is the one true God. The devil is called the God of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4. Jesus Christ is called a prince in Isaiah 9. The devil is called the prince of this world. He's the prince of the power of the air. He wants to be just like him. But his breath kindleth coals, and a flame goeth out of his mouth. Do you have a flame-proof suit to wear to go against him? Most likely you don't. Even if you did, it would still burn through it. No, you can't take him on. Job can't take him on. You need the Lord. That's what God's trying to get across is you need me. You can't take on Leviathan. So it says, in his breath, his breath kindleth coals, and a flame goeth out of his mouth. In his neck remaineth strength, and sorrow is turned into joy before him. So in his neck remaineth strength. You ever been around somebody, you just couldn't convince them to go the right way? They had a hard neck. You're not going to be able to convince the devil that he's a loser and he's losing to the Lord and he needs to just give up. You're not going to be able to convince him that. There's a lot of people like that. Proverbs 29:1. He that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. In his neck remaineth strength, and sorrow is turned into joy before him. And pretty much what that's saying is, you may be in sorrow, but once you see him, you're going to be jumping up and down ready to hide. It's going to send people that was sulking on the ground to jumping up in the air and running away. The flakes of his flesh are joined together. They are firm in themselves. They cannot be moved. Notice flesh, the flakes of his flesh. You know, we're talking about an actual creature, not just spirit. Leviathan is basically the devil in his natural state. So somewhere up there, way up there, in a physical place, you got the devil in his natural state. The flakes of his flesh are joined together. They are firm in themselves. They cannot be moved. Unless you're God. God can move them. He can move the unmovable. Somebody said, can God lift a rock so heavy? Or can God create a rock so heavy that he can't lift it? No, that's crazy talk. Because just, you know, God's almighty. But the question is just logically impossible. God can lift anything, so it would be impossible for him to create a rock so heavy that he can't lift it. That doesn't mean that God isn't all-powerful. That means that the question doesn't even make sense. God can move anything. God can move Leviathan. It says, Leviathan's heart is as firm as a stone, yea, as hard as a piece of the nether millstone. He's like the Grinch. His heart is 10,000 times too small and harder than the piece of the nether millstone. So it's hard and unyielding. The nether millstone, the stone that's on the bottom of the other stones. You see, you just take some stones and stack them on top of each other. Try to get the bottom one out. When he raiseth up himself, the mighty are afraid. By reason of breakings, they purify themselves. So he raiseth up himself. Imagine that dragon getting up in front of you and raising himself up and looking down at you. The mighty would run for cover. But you know what? When Jesus Christ comes back at the second coming, the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men, they hide in the dens and the rocks of the mountains. So when he raiseth up himself, and that's all he's concerned with is raising up himself. He's not concerned with raising up the Lord Jesus Christ. It says, by reason of breakings, they purify themselves. So here, you got like the Roman Catholic flagellation and doing penance to pay for your own sins by reason of breakings, just like the maniac of Gadara in Mark 5:5. He was all night in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Like those religious Baal worshippers, 1 Kings 18, they took something sharp and cut themselves. So cutting is a blood sacrifice. When people do that, they're doing a blood sacrifice, maybe trying to do penance or something for their own sins, which doesn't make sense because Jesus Christ is the only sacrifice for sins, and he suffered once for sins. But the devil likes a blood sacrifice. By reason of breakings, they purify themselves. The only way you're going to get pure is by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, not your own blood. It says, the sword of him that layeth at him cannot hold the spear, the dart, nor the habergeon. This is because these physical weapons are never going to be able to pierce Leviathan. You need the word of God that can pierce and cut asunder Leviathan. You need the weapons talked about in 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5, where it says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You know, we don't war after the flesh. It's a spiritual war. You need spiritual weapons, 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5. Because look what it says about him. He esteemeth iron as straw. You come at him with iron, it's going to break like straw. And brass as rotten wood. You try to hit him with brass, it's going to be like you're hitting him with a piece of rotten wood. It's just going to break. The arrow cannot make him flee. Sling stones are turned with him into stubble. Darts are counted as stubble. He laugheth at the shaking of a spear. You know, David came at Goliath with a stone that did some damage. You come at Goliath with a stone, he's just going to eat it. Darts are counted to him as stubble. He laugheth at the shaking of a spear. Sharp stones are under him. He spreadeth sharp pointed things upon the mire. You know, when he's swimming through there and he's got those sharp, hard stones under him, he's just going to crush them into powder underneath him. He maketh the deep to boil like a pot. He maketh the sea like a pot of ointment. He maketh a path to shine after him. One would think the deep to be hoary. So he makes the deep to boil like a pot. And that's talking about that deep up there way above the second heaven where, you know, Psalm 148:4 says, praise him, ye heavens of heavens, and ye waters that be above the heavens. So there's waters above the heavens, above the first heaven, our atmosphere, and the second heaven, where the stars are. There's a deep up there, a body of water up there. Under that sea of glass, there's a body of water, and there's Leviathan. And he maketh the deep to boil like a pot. But all God has to do is make a little hole in that sea of glass, drop that hook down in there, and he goes ice fishing for Leviathan. And he can catch him. Sometimes you might be the bait. But he maketh the sea like a pot of ointment. He maketh a path to shine after him. He maketh a path to shine after him. He makes sin look good. He makes the path, the broad way of destruction, he makes it look good. He decorates it. One would think the deep to be hoary. So he makes the broad way look good. It says, upon earth there is not his like who is made without fear. He has no fear. That's why his people have no fear of God before their eyes. They used to make clothes that said, no fear. And that's true. People have no fear of God. And this also shows this can't be an animal because animals fear man. This is more than just an animal. It says, he beholdeth all high things. Well, he is the prince of the power of the air. He is spiritual wickedness in high places. He was behind the Tower of Babel, that high thing, Genesis 11:4. He loves high places, Leviticus 26:30, Numbers 33:52, Isaiah 14:12 through 14. He wanted to ascend above the stars, the heights of the clouds. He's king over all the children of pride. Job 40 called him the chief of the ways of God. Ephesians 6:12 talks about principalities and powers, rulers of darkness. You see, the spirit world's got a hierarchy, and this is the king. He's the king of all the children of pride. He's the one over all the children of disobedience. Revelation 9 talks about an angel that's a king over the bottomless pit. So there's a hierarchy in the spirit world, and this is the chief of the ways of God. This is the chief conspirator, as Bob Dylan called him in that interview. And this is the guy that you can't mess with, but there's one man that can mess with him. That's the man Christ Jesus, who beats him every time. And it said, like it said in verse 17, they stick together, they cannot be sundered, talking about his scales. But the word of God can put him asunder. It can break through. Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. You can't do it on your own strength. It has to be the Lord Jesus Christ.